opportunities. The rest of us, let's take out our Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15, we're going to read in a moment verses 1 through 13 of Romans 15 and continue our series called Gospel Clarity, our study in the book of Romans. We've got 3 Sundays left, I think, in the book of Romans, if I'm counting right. Yeah, 3 Sundays left studying Romans. We started last September. And, we've been a little more than a year with a few breaks in the book of Romans, but it's been an incredible study, and I'm looking forward to sharing these verses with you today. So verse 1 of Romans chapter 15 begins, and it says this: "We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good to build him up. For Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures we might find hope. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ became a servant to the circumcised to show God's truthfulness in order to confirm the promises given to the patriarchs and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles and sing to your name. And again it said, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples extol him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will come, even he who arises to rule the Gentiles. In him will the Gentiles hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope." Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We ask that you would grant us comprehension and insight and wisdom today. That as we grasp these things with our mind, Lord, would you by your Spirit create in us a heart to be a people of welcome. Lord, that we would learn to embody these words that we find here, to welcome one another as Jesus has welcomed us. Lord, we think of that welcome, and even now, Lord, we know that your ear is turned to our prayers because of that welcome in Christ. So, Lord, would you grant us to embody and exemplify that as a people in Jesus' name? Amen. This passage shows us that the lived experience of welcome, a spirit of welcome and embrace, is the vision of a gospel-believing church. The main idea of the message this morning really is that the gospel, our belief in the gospel, produces a spirit of welcome in the church and welcome in its mission. That it's one of the characteristic marks of a people who believe the gospel is that they become a welcoming people. Not just on the surface in ways that are simple, but down to the core of who we are. We're the kind of people who can make space for others to be in our presence, to feel safe, to grow, to be transformed by the gospel. It creates welcome. In fact, the key verse in Romans 15, 1 through 13 that we just read may also be the key verse of practical theology of the entire book of Romans. The entire reason Paul writes the book of Romans is to deal with the disunity that existed in the church at Rome and encourage them, because of the gospel and the deep riches of mercy in it, to be a people who welcomed one another as Christ had welcomed them. Verse 7 says it plainly, "Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God." It's the key main idea in the middle of our passage that everything is built around. The ministry and work of Jesus Christ has made it possible for us to come into the transforming presence of God. This is what he's saying about the gospel. is that what Jesus did for us on the cross, his life, has made it possible for us to be invited into the transforming presence of God without fear of condemnation and shame. Romans 8:1. He's provided what is necessary for us to come to God before our sins have been cleaned up on our own, before we have reached maturity, and bring our real life into the light of his transforming love. He removed the guilt of our sin on the cross. He gave us the Holy Spirit like an adoption certificate of belonging to the family of God, and has promised that by his power, we will not be separated from his love until we are like him. And he did all of that at his own cost. And that is the welcome that the Apostle Paul is speaking about here. There's a quote from the book called The Gospel by Ray Ortland Jr. It'll be up on the screen here as I read it. But he captures this sense of welcome at the center of the church by saying this: I think of it with a simple equation. Gospel plus safety plus time. The family of God is where people should find lots of gospel, lots of safety, and lots of time. In other words, the people in our churches need multiple exposure to the happy news of the gospel from one end of the Bible to the other. They need the safety of non-accusing sympathy so that they can admit their problems honestly, and enough time to rethink their lives at a deep level. Because people are complex and changing is not easy. This is what he means when he says that we need to have this sense of spirit of welcome. And Paul says in verse 1 that this sort of environment described here, this is the sort of environment that mature people create around them as they bear with others for their good to build them up. We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves, he says. So, we are to do this despite weaknesses and failings that we find in one another. But we know that good welcome, like a good spirit of welcome and hospitality, it's an art of understanding the people around us, isn't it? Of understanding who people are. And truth be told, we are not naturally great at creating a sense of welcome in our lives individually. In any group you've ever been a part of, it's very easy to think about our own desires, our own needs, and very difficult for us to join someone else's frame of reference to create the necessary space of hospitality and welcome that is encouraged here. You know, this is especially true when we encounter a setting with people of a variety of different cultural backgrounds. You know, consider what we do when we greet one another each Sunday morning. You know, we've got a, you know, this is a limited place in time, in culture here, and even still, we're all different in many ways, aren't we? Many of us have grown up in different places with different situations. We're different ages. We've got different interests and things that have shaped us. We've all had that moment on a Sunday morning. I don't know about you. Maybe I'm the only one who does this, but you can play along and tell me if you do. We all have had that moment on a Sunday morning where we don't know what the other person is going to do when we greet them. You know what I'm talking about? Are you with me? It's sort of like, what am I going to do here? You know, I'm coming in here and we're saying hello, and I've got to greet the person. And, you know, it's always good to just, in a military sensitive church, just go with the standard handshake, right? I mean, if you're a Marine, look them in the eye, give the handshake, square your shoulders, right? You know, so it's like, let's just stay safe around here. And, you know, and for me, I've had all these occasions. And maybe you've had this experience. You know, I went in for the handshake and I got the fist bump. And now, here I am, I'm shaking the fist, right? So I'm not alone? Anybody else shaking a fist before instead of transitioning time to get the bump? And totally missed this greeting, so, you know, I'm sitting there shaking the fist. Then the next person is ready to dap me up. You know, and some of you are like, I don't even know what that means, but you know, you get up there and, I don't know if I can really, you know, hit and do that whole snap thing people do, you know, when they've kind of gotten real loose and, you know, snapped off the end. I'm like, I want to be cool. I want to even know what the rules are of that. Like, when do I go high? When do I slap low and pull back and snap? When do I throw in the, you know? And so, you know, sometimes I'm just like, yeah, we're going to go for the dap. You know, we're going to get in there. And right when I think I know that's what's it, you get pulled in and I'm in the bro hug. You know, and they've got my arm, and now I miss. I'm supposed to, that was just supposed to be the bro hug, you know, the handshake in the front and the hand around the back. But then it turns out I'm with Alex Chapman, and he's got me wrapped up in a full-on bear hug. There ain't nothing between. It's man-to-man. And I just don't know what's going on. And I've got all these, every time I greet you, I got all these things in my head, like, what are we doing here? You know, if you've ever had that bear hug, it can be something. And we haven't even included what you might expect in Asia, South America, Africa, Middle East. Anytime you're going to go spend time in another place, you have to learn a whole complex code of greetings to feel like an insider, right? All of that bears witness to the fact that and this is just how we greet one another, right? This is just how people experience an initial sense of belonging and welcome. But all of that bears witness to the fact that if we are going to create a genuine spirit of welcome, we have a lot to learn, don't we? And there's a lot that we need to learn about one another. And there's a certain posture of heart that is really necessary. And this passage helps us get in the right mindset to go beyond greetings to a genuine spirit of welcome that can pervade the church and create that kind of environment that bears witness to the gospel. And the first thing that we see in that is that a spirit of welcome, he shows us in the first few verses of this passage, that a real spirit of welcome that goes beyond all of those greetings embraces a shared reputation. The gospel actually calls us as a people to embrace a shared reputation with one another. This section is connected back to the beginning of chapter 14. If you've got your Bibles open, you could look there. We're in verse 3. We're told that we have a responsibility to welcome into our life the one whom God has welcomed. That we're supposed to welcome the one whom God has welcomed and avoid casting judgment about secondary issues. That welcome precedes all of that. It's the priority over that. We see that there in verse 3 of chapter 14. The gospel and our belonging to God in Christ creates a basis for being together even when we disagree or have differences that go beyond the gospel, that go beyond the central beliefs of Christianity, that we're to learn a sense of welcome and agreement and make sure that as we disagree, we don't erase a sense of welcome to those who God has himself welcomed into his family. In the text here, Paul takes it further. He says, then here in this chapter, he says that the strong, which here means the one who has a mature view of the gospel and his freedoms, has an obligation to bear with, he says, the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Notice that in the first verse. Not to please ourselves. Meaning, give up some of your understood freedoms to make the environment of the church more welcoming to those who may have a sensitive conscience, even in things that are not directly required of Christians. And we've been talking about that for the last couple weeks. And in the context, Paul is likely talking about the fact there at the beginning in the first few verses that Torah-observant Jews had been cast out of Rome at some point prior to him writing Romans. And they were in a weak place in the city of Rome societally. When Nero came back to the throne in the early days of the Roman Emperor Nero's reign, he actually allowed Jewish people who had been cast out to come back into the city. And there's a lot tied to that, and I'm not going to get into all the history of it, but they came back into the city, and what had happened is there were also many of them who had become Christians. They begun to follow Jesus, believe in the Messiah, and now they're coming back, and they're coming into Gentile, primarily Roman churches. And they have a lot of dietary restrictions and concerns that they bring with them. And so they were a part of the crowd in the church that had the most hang-ups about what they would eat or not. And so there's so much emphasis here on food. And although the relationships they now had as professing Christians didn't require them to continue to observe these Jewish dietary laws, They struggled to feel that freedom. They weren't free in their conscience. And so the last couple passages talked and spoke to that. So by welcoming them into the church, there was a need to limit for those who were there and in the culturally strong position. There was a need to limit some of the ways that they would exercise their freedoms when they would gather together for fellowship. And by gathering with Jewish background Christians also, these Roman Christians could become associated with some of the ways that general Roman culture rejected people from a Jewish background. And so it wasn't just about the food, it was that they were seen as fringe and outcast to society. But now these were Christians who God had welcomed into their family, and it was complicated. And by being associated with them, these Gentile Roman Christians who may have had respectable reputations in the community now consider themselves family with these Jewish Christians that are it's questionable whether we really want them in the city at all. And to be together as a family meant, I'm going to give up my social status and reputation and possibly be associated with these Jewish brothers and sisters, no matter what the people around me think about that. This is why he says then in this passage that the Roman Christians who were in this stronger standing culturally were in danger of a sort of rejection by association with their Jewish Christian brothers and sisters. And Paul says, don't worry about how it's going to affect your reputation. That is what love and welcome does. Instead of separating, it draws us near in Christ. Now that's important. It draws near even when it means, he says, sharing in the reproaches of others. That means the negative reputation or the ways in which their standing is going to reflect on us. It draws near even when that's the case. And to power that insight, to say this is how you need to live, he says this is what Jesus has done in receiving any of us. He's saying we're just doing a basic imitation of what Jesus did to save us. Jesus bore our reproaches. You notice he quotes there in verse 3, for Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. What does he mean by that? Well, our negative reputation and our failings, our sin, fell on Jesus at the cross. Jesus bore our sins on the cross, paid our sin debt, and was willing to do that to associate with us and bring us into his family. And he paid all of that cost. This is the good news of the gospel. We were outcasts, but Jesus was inside the glories of the relationship with God the Father. And he came and he crossed over to become like us as a servant. And then he drew so near to us that he took on our sin and associated with us so deeply that he paid for our sins on the cross so that we could be forgiven. So welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you to the glory of God. This is what Paul is saying. Now, sometimes I find that Christians who believe the same gospel, what does this have to do with us? Sometimes I find that Christians who believe the same gospel are embarrassed to be associated with other Christians because they're embarrassed by the positions they hold on secondary issues. Maybe the way they talk about their politics, and we've been talking about all different things. Maybe the decisions they make culturally, what they decide to participate in or not participate in. And depending on where you stand, you might feel like, I don't want to be seen as like them. Well, this is cutting to the middle of this. It says, actually, anyone whom God has received through genuine faith in the gospel, that we're to act in such a way that although those may seem like significant things, if they're secondary and they're not ultimately about this relationship with God we have in Christ, but secondary things about how we try to wisely live that out, we need to give enough space where we don't forget to welcome one another and recognize one another's family. The sort of divisions that we see in our culture and churches shouldn't tear us apart. There will be times where you will have to bear the ongoing cost of building a genuine community of welcome in the body of Christ. And because Christ has welcomed you, you should be ready to endure what is necessary to welcome others who believe this truth. who are your family in Christ, and whom one day you will spend eternity in heaven with, praising God. So that's the first thing we see. Then we see a second thing. We see that not only does it cause us to embrace this sense of shared reputation, because Jesus has done that, we also see that a spirit of welcome experiences our differences as a blessing. It experiences the differences that we have as a blessing. Verse 5 then, Paul begins with endurance. He says, "May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus." Paul begins with endurance, but by the time we get into verse 5, he's turning the corner to embrace. He's not just saying, hey, endure those people who maybe you otherwise don't agree with a lot and maybe find frustrating because of their differences. And not just endure them, but there's a call here actually to begin to embrace the fact that God has purposed the differences in the body as a way of showing something more valuable. More valuable than our agreement is the harmony that is created by the gospel when people disagree, but they love one another anyway. And he's showing that as we look through these words that he has here in verse 5 and 6. Paul wants us to see God as enduring us and Christ Jesus as the one we align ourselves with in one accord so that we create a different picture. He gives us a picture of unity. And here's what he says unity is. He gives us a picture of unity as the right relationship of our diversity around the gospel of Christ. So what's unity in his mind? When he says the church should be unified, when he's calling us to unity, he's not saying get rid of everything that's different about you. Check your differences at the door. He's actually not saying that. He's actually saying bring your differences in, but relate them to the gospel in such a way that they produce harmony. And so it's a really, really important idea for us to understand. He shows us unity as the right relationship of our differences around the person of Jesus Christ, who alone is our hope. To do so, he uses this word for harmony here. That's a musical term. And calls us to glorify God with one voice. You see the musical term there? We got harmony and glorifying God with one voice. And you know, I realized this week as I asked some people that unless you're a musician, many people don't know what harmony is. So I've got some folks who are going to help me out. Y'all come on up here and we're going to see this. And as they're making their way up here to help us understand this, I want you to see that it's a word picture that says, let's not get rid of all of our differences and ask people to set aside who they are and their culture at the door of a bland church of similarity. Let's not do that. Instead, we do something different. You see, harmony is a unique idea. It's not everyone singing the same note. It's singing a different note in right relationship with one another. So where are we at here, you guys? All right, come on up here. Hey, can you show your appreciation for them being willing? I sprung this on them this morning, so just to defend them. But you know, in music, we could first have somebody just sing a particular note. People could sing alone. So, Chapman, why don't you?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below.
I mean, isn't that great? I mean, Chapman's an incredible singer. We have so many talented singers here at Pillar. But Victoria's voice is different than Chapman's. She's going to sing the same thing. And, you know, we're going to hear how her voice is different.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below.
That's so good. Yeah. You know, and some of you are like, man, why do some people get all the gifts, right? Like, why are some people so talented? And we could have Carrie do it, but, you know, we're gonna move past it because we get to hear Carrie sing, and, you know, we know he's got an amazing voice. But in a moment, what's going to happen is you're going to hear, they were singing the same notes. They would just sing the same notes back to back with different voices. But in addition to singing the same notes with different voices, you can sing different notes in right relationship with one another. So I want you to listen close, because in a minute, they're going to sing, and they're going to sing the first line, which is very familiar to you, and they're all going to sing the same note, okay? But when they get to the second line, you're going to hear them change where they're actually layering a chord with different notes, and that's harmony. The beginning is unison, melody, and then we're going to hear harmony. So I want you to listen close to the difference. You guys ready to do this? This is the big moment.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
Keep going. Come on. Sing along if you know it.
Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
That is harmony. All right, give them, thank them for joining us. Appreciate you guys doing that. And you see, when they changed, what you had was the beauty of different notes in right relationship with one another, and it creates a whole thing that's even better. This is the vision of welcome. See, this is the picture He gives us. You know, when we go into this verse 5, He says, may the God of endurance and encouragement grant you, that's you, to live in such harmony together, this right relationship of your differences, not the erasure of your differences, but to live in such harmony together that it comes together in Christ Jesus, that together you might with one voice, so that, you know, when they changed that, it's like, it was just like one glorious voice related to one another, catching us up into the beauty of music. And He says that's the picture, actually, of being okay with the presence of differences that are still related appropriately to the good news of Jesus Christ. And all of us are walking towards Him, but we value the unique places we're at and the unique cultures we come from. And we glorify God by bringing those all together in one voice. This is the vision of the church. This is who we should long to be. This should be the picture that we aspire to. Most churches seem to aim for similarity. And you see, you can't get harmony that Paul is calling for here without difference. The differences are not just tolerable or to be endured, they're preferred. You see, this is the move from embracing them as something to endure and put up with differences to saying the presence of these differences among us, all related to Christ, is better. I would rather have that. I would rather learn to live in a body of people who bring all of those differences to the table, and we learn to gather ourselves around Jesus Christ, to submit ourselves to Jesus Christ, and let Him take those differences, relate them together, and with one voice we glorify God. Wouldn't you want to be a part of a church like that? Let me tell you, I think not only would people want to be a part of a church like that, people outside of the church would be confused to find a church like that. And they would long to know what could possibly bring that kind of unity. Most churches are dominated by the cultural preferences of the prevailing group of people in it, rather than exemplifying a willingness to embrace differences that display harmony. We want church to be done in a particular way and sing a certain style of music, keep to a particular form of expectations in worship. We will need at times, if we want to see this vision happen, to expand our willingness to embrace cultural expressions of gathering together and worship and greeting and eating that affirm and welcome the differences of those who come from different backgrounds. Leading the church then is much more like being a composer or a conductor that seeks to bring the variety of sounds in an orchestra into good relationship with one another in a way like that. So as a pastor with a missionary heart, I ask this question, what do we have to do to make space for the diverse people of Eastern Prince William County to find a place of belonging and welcome here at Pillar Church? What do we have to be willing to do? create that kind of welcome? What about my own preferences and your preferences? What about our preferences do we need to learn to care about less? And what about Jesus do I need to learn to care about more? So that this can be a place of welcome for the diverse people of Prince William County. When we care about those sort of questions, we will be on our way to a genuine spirit of welcome produced by the gospel. Which brings me to my last point. A spirit of welcome equips us for our mission. See, in a lot of ways, the last couple weeks, I've been talking about what happens in here. How we relate to the differences that we might have together in this body, or those who will come and join in it. And we've been thinking through what it looks like to prioritize the gospel, to build our church around Jesus, to give space for the fact that people are going to have differences in many things that are going to be important to some of us. But that we can find a sense of harmony with one voice to glorify God, and we've been painting this picture. But verse 8 in this passage, and really the rest of the book of Romans, represents a shifting of attention from that inward creation of unity, because it moves from thinking intently about the experience of welcome in this specific church to putting our attention on the historic and global mission of God to reconcile all peoples to himself through the gospel of Jesus Christ and to proclaim God's welcome among the nations that are diverse and different and vast and beautiful and wild, that we can go experience the glory of God in the midst of the world that God has created. It moves our attention from us to the mission to reconcile all peoples to God through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Part of the calling for unity and welcome in the body is because the same mindset and heart that is needed to create genuine transformational relationships in the body here is the same heart and mindset needed to join God in his mission of salvation to the world as we follow him into the nations. In the text, he begins by displaying Jesus as a cross-cultural missionary servant. Look at verse 8. For I tell you that Christ became a servant to the circumcised to show God's truthfulness. You know, in shorthand, what does he mean when he's saying that? He says, here's what Christ did. He's speaking to Jews and Gentiles in the Roman church. He's saying the second person of the Trinity who has been God from eternity past, the divine Son who enjoyed the right relationship with the Father and Spirit eternally and everlastingly, that divine Son made a decision to cross from that culture of heaven into the culture of our world as a servant. And he took on flesh that made him vulnerable and weak, where he could bear reproach with other people. And he embraced that in such a way that he became a servant to the Jewish people to fulfill the promise of God that he would send a Savior through them. He became a servant to them, but also it says he became a servant through them to the Gentiles who would find hope for God's mercy through that. And so what we have going on here, he shows Jesus as a cross-cultural servant. And then you notice there are two phrases, the end of verse 8, in order to, and verse 9, in order that. That just means here's the reason Jesus became a missionary servant by taking on flesh and dwelling in our midst and drawing near to us. Here's why he did it. Now the answer to the Jewish Christians was most obviously, in order to confirm the promises given to the patriarchs. This is Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the fathers of the Jewish people. And he said, and the answer, in one sense, is to fulfill these promises of sending a Messiah to the Jewish people who would make them a dwelling place for God's blessing. That God would be shown to have kept his promise. And the Jewish Christians would have said, amen! The answer to the Gentile Christians was most obviously in verse 9, in order that the Gentiles, he did that so that, in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. So he didn't just do that among the Jewish people to keep his promises, but what this passage is saying is that he kept his promises so that both the Jewish promises could be given to them, they could enjoy the blessing of God, and that through keeping his promises to the Jewish people, that the nations could find mercy in Jesus Christ. And so each one of these groups is saying, I like that answer. I like that answer. But the answer to God, Paul, and as demonstrated here in verses 9 through 12 by four quotes, is both. He did both of those things because he cared about both of them. The Jewish Messiah, Jesus Christ, would come as a cross-cultural servant to bring both Jews and Gentiles into the family of God to the praise of his glory. In this church, will not be able to participate in the big mission of God. The church in Rome he's writing to, they're not going to be able to participate in the big mission of God going forward to the Gentiles unless together they find unity around that gospel promise. And we won't either. This church will not be able to participate in the big mission of God if we can't learn to serve one another's differences in the body of Christ while maintaining a joyful, familial unity together despite our differences. It's so critical. Living out the welcome of the gospel among us prepares us to join the mission beyond us, to go where places where we'll have to work even harder to understand people's differences. We will not be able to go to the nations with reconciling hope in Jesus Christ if we cannot navigate the differences we have among ourselves here. We just simply won't be capable of it. This is the learning lab for the sending mission of God. This is where we learn to do what we have to do to fulfill God's mission for us. People around the world and here love to share who they are. It's one of the great joys of being human is to actually share ourselves and be rejoiced in. It's so critical to experiencing a sense of welcome. God made the world a diverse and wild and beautiful place. And if we're so convinced of our own cultural superiority and superiority of perspective, we will find ourselves unable to see the pathways to sharing the heart of a God in ways that gets to the heart of the people that God loves. Listen. Here's what we need to do. We need to listen and learn and understand and sympathize and pray. Set aside your superiority and serve. And then and only then will you see clearly to proclaim the love of Christ to others far and wide. Now this is the heart of what he's talking about. Remember a few years ago, I was in Bali, Indonesia, and I was with Nyoman, who we've prayed for, and we were up in the village of Munduk Dawa, and we were kind of just greeting people in the village that he'd grown up in, and he wanted to particularly visit a man who was fairly bedridden, and it was obvious that he wasn't able to get out and get many personal services, and he wasn't clean, he wasn't well kept, his hair was super long, his beard was long, and Nyoman really wanted to go and try to connect with him and share the gospel, and we went there, and I wasn't sure what we were going to do, because obviously I didn't speak the language, but Nyoman is bold and fun to be around, and so we go into this place, and before long, I'm looking around, and Nyoman has, like, got the guy sitting in a chair, and he starts trimming his beard, you know, he gets out some scissors, and he starts cutting his hair. He gives the guy a bath. And I'm sitting here, I was like, I've been a pastor for like 16 years. I've never given someone a bath. I'm not cutting anybody's hair. You know, I don't even like cutting my own hair. And you know, he cares. I just watched him care for this man. And while he's doing it, he's talking about Jesus. Just over and over, he's talking about Jesus. And I thought, you know, what a powerful picture. Just entering into this guy's world. It wasn't about what he wanted to accomplish or what he was going to build through the person or some sort of thing he wanted to try to accomplish. He just knew that he had to go to where that man was and where his needs were, understand him despite all the differences that they shared, and and love him. And that in doing that, he would not only just honor the image of God in this man, but he would get to remind that man of the God who gave him that image and wants to restore him. And I'll just never forget that, because that's the picture of the missionary heart. That's the picture that would bind us together in unity if we care most deeply about that kind of welcome and love and care. And then we proclaim that with joy. There's no telling what God can do through our lives individually and corporately. So I'll end just with what Paul says. He says, "Now, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing this, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope." I ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes as we prepare for the Lord's Supper. As we go into a moment of prayer and reflection here at the end of the sermon, maybe you just need to take a moment with the Lord and just respond to what he has been speaking to you about in this. And you might be here today and you'd say, "I've never experienced the welcome of God. I never knew that Jesus paid for my sin so that I could be, by grace, through faith, forgiven and welcomed into his family." And today, maybe you just respond to the Lord and say, "Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know that I've walked away from you in life, and I want a relationship with you. And today, as best as I know how, I want to turn to you and come home." Just express that from your heart to God, and the Lord hears your prayers, and you can take this first step of stepping into God's welcome in a new relationship with him. You know, maybe you've been a Christian for a long time. You haven't thought much about what it means to care for others, to create a sense of welcome, not just on Sunday mornings, but with your life and in the body of Christ. Maybe you just need to confess that to the Lord and ask for him to create a new capacity and heart and desire for you to be that kind of person that would realize this vision we've seen from his word today. Father, we thank you, and we ask that you'd make us a welcoming people, not because it's strategic, not because it would be just good, but, Lord, because, first of all, we've experienced such powerful welcome from you. Lord, would you allow that to permeate us, fill us with joy, fill us with faith to believe that right now, Lord, your arms are open wide to us to invite us, just as we are, to come. Come experience your love, be reminded of our purpose, be pointed in the direction of our life that would glorify you. Lord, that it's safe there, for there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because the law of the Spirit that indwells us has set us free from the law of sin and death. God, I pray that you would fill us with a sense of your embrace and your presence, your love for us, so that we might become a welcoming people. Lord, let the nations would know you and be glad, that they would be beckoned to enter into your household just as they are. And with one voice, we would learn to glorify you